G'day there, you're watching the Aussie Bim Guru, and today we're going to be benchmarking Grasshopper and Dynamo, because I've been looking at both programs during my career so far, but especially Grasshopper recently. So we're going to compare them as fairly as possible, which is quite hard. So essentially, if you haven't seen Grasshopper before, I do have one video on my channel at the moment that covers the basics. Essentially, it's a visual coding language, which can achieve a lot of complex outcomes. For example, some highly complex geometry that respects a lot of mathematical functions. There's a really strong community and there's a lot of support for it as well. Whereas Dynamo is a very similar program in what it tries to do. However, it really is built in particular to work with Revit data and Revit objects specifically. Whereas Grasshopper is made to work within Rhino and doesn't read Revit elements. So that's the key difference between them, but I thought it's worth benchmarking their speed against each other just to show people how different they perform, especially when dealing with geometry. So it's also worth being aware about Rhino inside Revit, which is a new package for Grasshopper, which essentially allows Rhino to work within the Revit environment. So you can take advantage of the speed of Grasshopper's geometry engine within Revit itself. In future, I will be covering this on my channel, probably hopefully in a month or two. But there's a lot of stuff going around at the moment on YouTube about it, so I definitely recommend checking it out. So let's actually just compare them a little bit. So I've actually already got Rhino and Revit open. So I've got Revit and Dynamo, and Rhino and Grasshopper. So let's just start with Grasshopper to begin with. So we're just gonna make a simple geometric function to compare the speed of how quickly you can change and iterate between the programs. So we're just gonna start by making a couple of control point based curves. So I'm just gonna create one, and I'll create another one. Essentially, we're going to create a tunnel of arcs between these two curves. If anyone's followed my LinkedIn, you'll have already seen that I sort of started benchmarking the programs using this technique. So we're just going to make a curve in Grasshopper, and we're going to make another curve as well. We're going to set one of our curves to this, and the other one of our curves to the other. And essentially, we want to divide these curves. So I'm just going to create a number slider between two, and we'll set it to 10 by default, all the way up to 15,000. So we're gonna really push the capabilities of these software. We're gonna divide these curves up to 15,000 times and then create an arc between them. From there, we need to divide our curves by this number. So we'll take one of our curves, divide it by this number. I would use copy and paste. However, I'm finding that occasionally copy and paste doesn't work in Grasshopper. It responds to Rhino instead. So that's why I'm not using some of those functions. But essentially at this point, we have a way of dividing these curves. You can see obviously that we really quickly increase our density of curves. So maybe for now, we might just make this 1000. Just so we can actually see the filigree of what we're doing. So let's just set this to 10 for now. Okay, what we need to do from there is actually create a bi-arc. So essentially we're gonna be creating a set of bi-arcs between these. So we'll get our bi-arc node, and essentially our bi-arc is looking for a few things. So it's looking for our start point of the bi-arc, our end point, and then it's looking for the tangent at the bi-arc, which in this case is the z-axis. So we're gonna be creating some longest lacing functions, and we're also gonna be creating a z-vector in the unit z-direction. We're going to be reversing this for our normal, and for each of our points, we will be creating a vector in longest lacing. And likewise, looks like my copy paste function is working. We'll be doing the same for this. And essentially we're feeding in our points, their vectors, our points and their vectors. You can see at that point, this doesn't quite work. So we actually need to feed in the non-reverse vector. There we go. And now we get a bi-arc tunnel. It looks like my internet speed's sort of impacting the performance of how this is graphically appearing, but you can see at least, there we go. When I'm not panning around, you can see how quickly this can update, and it's not even struggling. I'm going up to 1,000 at the moment, and it's not even chugging at all. So again, we'll just go back to maybe like 78 for now. So let's go and do this in Dynamo as well. So we're gonna set up the same function, but just in a different program. So I'm gonna have to create some model curves, and I'll need to create them a little bit differently. So we're gonna draw a spline, as they call it in Revit, and we're just gonna create a few points again. And we'll just do another one. Cool. So we're going to be getting some select model element nodes. One really big difference that always throws me off is that in Grasshopper you double click to search, in Dynamo you right click. So I find I'm constantly doing that accidentally between the two programs now. I'll go to manual mode as well. It's really important to note that difference as well. Dynamo and Grasshopper don't operate the same way. So Dynamo can go into manual mode quite easily, whereas in Grasshopper you need to change a different setting in order to only run when you tell it to run. But most people will run in automatic mode in Grasshopper typically. Okay, so I'm just gonna just remake these in manual mode. And I'll just disable my tool. Okay, so I'm gonna select one curve and another curve. One really big difference in Dynamo as well is geometry preview. So you actually can see your geometry within the Dynamo environment. So when I get element geometry, which is another key difference, Dynamo needs you to say, I want the geometry of this element, whereas Grasshopper just creates it automatically. There are quite a lot of assumptions that Grasshopper makes, pretty much always correct assumptions as well. At the moment, I haven't run yet, of course. And there you go, there's my curves within Dynamo. Okay, so at this point I need to divide my curve. So let's go, notice I keep double clicking to find things. So let's try by curve and divisions. So we've got a NURB curve at the moment, or a spline. So we'll take our curve and we'll create a number slider. And we'll just do the same parameters for this. 0, 1,000, and a step of 1. Actually, we need to do 2. And let's just start at maybe 47. And run. Okay, interesting. Okay, I need to do a dynamo curve. That's interesting. It's asking me for an element curve. I think I need to turn these into polylines potentially. No, I need to do split by parameter, that's why. So the way that you divide a spline in Dynamo is quite different. So what we need to do instead is create a slider, which is going to be the number of our divisions, but then we need to create a sequence. So the way that you divide is a little bit different in Dynamo, a little bit trickier. So we're going to create a range. This will essentially make a set of divisions between 0 and 1. So these are going to be the points of parameters along the spline. So we'll feed in our parameters, take our curve, run our script, and now you see we have our points instead. So we split by parameter, and then we get the start point of each of those segments. So it's a lot more lengthy in order to work with this versus Grasshopper, but there you go. Now we have this. We can go into automatic mode as well. And now as we change this, we'll note our points changing. But note that I'm getting up to about 600 and it's already getting a lot slower. It's already chugging. So we can already note that there's already a fair bit of complication coming in through Dynamo working with geometry, which is, you know, a little bit disappointing. But you know, to be expected because we're dealing with geometry here, and Rhino's geometry engine is much more powerful than Revit's. But what we'll do is just also feed in the same, but to this curve. So we're going to be loading it up twice as much now. So now we're creating two sets of divided points. Still chugging quite a bit, but still keeping up at least. It's almost giving us real time feedback. There's no hourglass loading, for example. So what we're gonna do then is we're gonna create that Z vector the same way we did before, and then reverse it as well. And hopefully you're doing this at home as well. I recommend that you do, just so you can really compare them and you can really feel the difference. So we need to reverse the vector the same way we have in Grasshopper. And essentially now we need to create an arc by start end. By start, end, and tangencies. So again, we're going to have our point, and we're going to have our vector, and we'll have our second point, and we'll have its vector. And actually, it looks like I might need to fix this one up. So what we actually need to do is feed in the reverse for both. And there you go. So now we have our tunnel, essentially the same as what we had before. So we could benchmark purely on this basis at this point, but what I want to do is also manage some geometry preview nodes to really set some more data in motion and really benchmark them based on this. So we're going to set a gradient depending on the length of the curves along the bi-arc tunnel. So we're going to create a curve length node, and I'll go back to Grasshopper and do this in a sec as well. So we'll get the length of each curve, which should be a number. We're going to have to remap the range. We can also flatten this first as well. Note that in Grasshopper you can actually flatten outputs within the node body as well, which is really nice. So we're going to remap our range to a number between 0 and 1. So we'll take our curve length and we'll remap between 0 and 1. And this essentially is so we can map this along a gradient range between 0 and 1. So now all those numbers should represent that range. Okay, so what we need to do at this point is we need to create a color range, which is a little bit harder than in Grasshopper. So I'm just gonna get a couple of color nodes from Clockwork. So we'll just get color green, color red, and we'll get color blue. I could write these colors natively using color by ARGB. I'm just saving myself a little bit of time. We're going to create a list with these three colors just to create our color range. So we'll go red, green, and blue. And I'll go back and turn off some of my geometry previews in a second, just so we only see the colored version. Okay, so what we need to do then is map this color range using list count. And you'll notice how much easier this is going to be to do in Grasshopper, this whole step. This is why I'm doing it. So we'll go 0 through to 1, and we'll step at an increment of x, just so we can create those three positions along the gradient map at 0, 0.5, and 1. After that, we need to create a color range. So we'll feed in our colors, and our indices, and our values. Now we have a range of colors that will represent what our override color for our geometry preview is. So we're going to do geometry color. So bar geometry color. So our color will be these, and our geometry will be our curves. And this should generate a set of color geometry. So what I need to do is just go back and hide all of the non-colored versions. And there you go. Now you can see we have a color range that responds based on the size. So you can obviously move these and Dynamo should respond and pick up the change. And you'll see it is. And you'll see as the curve's changing length, the color will also change as well. If I go back to the start, I can also adjust the number of divisions along the tunnel. But you'll notice it's already getting slower. I can feel the chug. The slider's not keeping up. It's taking time to catch up with me. So I'd say around maybe 1,000 is really the limit of what this can really handle without significantly slowing down. Let's go back to Grasshopper and do the same set of operations. So we're going to be taking a slightly different approach in order to do this, but we are going to get the length of the curve first. So we're going to go curve length, same approach, and we're going to get the length of this curve or the bi-arc. Notice everything's instantaneously happening. There's no speed, there's no slowdown. I don't have to keep hitting run as well. If I'm running in a manual mode, I'm just working on automatic here. What we're gonna do now is get a min max. And I've got this from a package called Heteroptera, which will just find the minimum and the maximum item in a list. So really straightforward, no remapping required because we're gonna be using a gradient in order to map our colors. The same way we have in Dynamo. So pretty much all it needs is a set of values and a minimum and a maximum. So we've got our minimum, we've got our maximum, and we just need our values now. And that will create a range of gradient values. And you'll see how quick that was compared to Dynamo. There's a much more straightforward workflow. I think because it's been around longer and they've really taken the time to think about how easy these things should be. So we're going to get a preview or a custom preview, and we'll take our geometry and we'll take our colors and done. How quick was that? But on top of that, some of the components in Grasshopper are much more intuitive. They have a lot more options. So if I right click this, you can see I've got a lot of presets I can pick from already. So it's not like I have to really custom map my gradient range if one of these already gets the job done. So a lot easier to work with, in my opinion. What we can do is just turn off the preview of our bio, because now we can see our custom preview in color. Note that the custom preview is obviously within Rhino. It's not like in Dynamo where it only occurs within Revit when the colors occur. So that's a little bit more dynamic, but essentially that's it. That was like 10 seconds, I reckon, versus a couple of minutes. And let's just start cranking this up as well and see if it gets any slower. Up it goes, and it's really not really slowing down at all. So let's get a little bit shaky. Let's really push our values up now. So we'll go back to 15,000. And let's just keep going and see how it goes. And it's still going, slowing down a little bit now, but it's pretty much keeping up. It's still almost in real time and not really a challenge for it. Let's go to Dynamo. And as you can expect, this is probably not gonna work as well. So we'll go to 15,000. I'm sorry, Dynamo, you're gonna hate me for this. And let's just start dragging. Already, it just does not want to do it. You can see it's spinning, it's really struggling. It may crash, possibly, but it will get there in the end. All right, we got to about 8,500. It's still thinking, still spinning, and still spinning. Yeah, it got there. You can obviously type in explicit results, which will be a little bit faster. So let's just go straight to 15,000. But you can see that I'm already not responding. It looks like it's gonna really struggle to get there. It will get there, it did, but it really struggled. So I think in terms of benchmarking them based on just a little example like this, you can see the power of the Rhino engine is really adding a lot of performance to how we're able to work with geometry. So if I go back to 5,000, done. If I go back to 15,000, done. It's very quick. Obviously Grasshopper can't read Revit element data. That is one thing that I still use Dynamo for a lot. And obviously if you have to work within Revit, then it's not as easy to work with Grasshopper because you have to use Rhino inside. It's a new tool, it's a new workflow. Definitely look into it. But hopefully this sort of helps show the relative speed differences between them just in a simple geometric exercise. So I think it just really comes down to whether you're using geometry and complex generation workflows, so such as generative design workflows, for example, versus just working directly with Revit. I think that's the two reasons why you should use Grasshopper or Dynamo. In my opinion, you should learn both. I think that they're both really valuable tools, and I'm going to be covering some videos on Grasshopper for very practical use over maybe the next couple of weeks. So there'll be a few Dynamo videos next week, and then after that I'll be doing a couple of weeks of Grasshopper videos. I'm still quite new to it, but they're going to be things that I've already started using Grasshopper for at work. So I think they'll really help you see practical use for Grasshopper as well. So hopefully that helps give you a better idea of the two platforms and how they measure up. Definitely have a play with them yourselves, see what you think. Feel free to leave any comments down below if you agree, disagree on my assessments. Obviously that it's not the most fair assessment because the geometry engine is so much more powerful, but that's really what I love about Grasshopper, so it's fair to me. If you're not already following and subscribing, feel free to do so. I make videos about 2 to 3 times a week and plan to do so for a very long time, as long as I can. And hopefully I'll see you in the next video. Thanks. Take care. Bye.